What do you get when you cross Mobile Suit Gundam with the sun-bleached post-apocalyptic world of Mad Max? Well, after War Gundam X might not be a perfect cross-section of those two properties, but it's as close as we're gonna get. Directed by Shinji Takamatsu, who's of course a veteran of various Sunrise productions such as School Rumble and The Brave of Gold Goldran, as well as multiple Gundam series including both Zeta and Double Zeta. After War Gundam X was one of those shows that really piqued my interest when first getting into the franchise. Something about the design of the various suits, the music, and the color tone of the show really drew me in. I mean, this show pulls off a blood-red sky incredibly well on multiple occasions. Gundam X is also sort of a strange beast when it comes to viewership. The series was released in Japan from April to December of 1996, but it wouldn't actually be released officially to Western audiences for almost a full 20 years. Western fans were finally able to get an official DVD release way back in 2016, and the actual Blu-rays were released in 2020. While personally I really liked Gundam X, it would seem that its reception, at least initially, was relatively mixed. Its viewership actually dropped so sharply over the first four episodes that it was cut from a full year-long series down to only 39 episodes, which sounds kind of familiar, doesn't it? I don't know why Gundam had such bad luck back then, but they just really couldn't catch a break, could they? Despite not being a show set in the Universal Century, Gundam's original and most expanded timeline, Gundam X has a heavy focus on the concept of Newtypes. Yes, the humans with strange psychic powers are of utmost importance in this show, which is something that is going to be an immediate negative for a lot of people out there that prefer their mecha with a more grounded and realistic focus. I will say, however, that Gundam X is probably the least mystical that Newtypes get. They are heavily focused on, and their existence isn't something to be debated, at least among the main cast. It's an interesting look at a part of the series that's both very important and also very divisive. I've heard that among fans, Gundam X is sort of an odd one out, much like Double Zeta. It never really gets talked about. People either are kind of lukewarm on it or they haven't seen it. I kind of credit that to the fact that it was stuck within the shores of Japan for 20 years. But the fact that it's almost never talked about makes it one of the more attractive series to me, at least personally. So without further ado, welcome back to the Gundam Retrospective, and let's take a look at After War Gundam X. Gundam X opens 15 years before the series proper. Of course, the SRA does what space rebels do and threaten to drop a colony on Earth. I'm sorry, did I say a colony? I meant, every colony. Yep, they drop a majority of their colonies on the Earth, which not only damages the planet to the point where large swaths of it become uninhabitable, but also wipes out most of the human population. Humanity is a tough old broad, though, and much like the noble cockroach, we tend to hang on through the worst of the worst, which is basically what we see in the opening episode of Gundam X. A desert town is ripped from its normal everyday hustle and bustle by a bandit piloting a mobile suit. Mobile suits in this series are really interesting, and they're usually held by bandits, groups of mercenaries, and remnants of the old military. Everybody is just trying to scrape together enough cash to survive, whether it's through raiding settlements, providing security, or scavenging pre-war technology. Luckily for this town, our MC Garod Ron is a legitimate mad lad and takes on the mobile suit with little more than a grappling hook, and wins quite easily. A well-dressed man observes this from afar and approaches Garod with a job offer. This guy asks Garod to find a young girl named Tifa Adil, who's been kidnapped by a band of violent vultures. Vultures are roving bands of salvagers that pick the ruins of the old world clean through the use of huge hovering land battleships. Apparently, this group is also into kidnapping, so Garrod accepts the job and sets out to find the battleship Freedon. It's really no issue for Garrod to sneak aboard the lumbering ship once he finds it. He even takes the opportunity to steal a mobile suit control unit, which looks like an RC car controller. Finally, he finds the young woman, and is able to convince her to escape with him fairly easily. However, when they return to Garrod's quest giver in town, Tifa freaks out, and Garrod just figures he doesn't want any of that and speeds off. The two are chased by mobile suits, and we kind of get the feeling that Tifa is much more than just a regular kidnapping victim. They flee into an old UNE mobile suit factory, where they come across the show's namesake, the GX9900 Gundam X. They both hop inside, and Garrod is able to activate the mobile suit with the stolen control unit. He's able to get up and fight off the suits that were chasing them, only to be confronted by two Gundam-class mobile suits arriving on the scene. So as a first episode, this introduces a lot to the viewer. Not just the fact that the world has been pretty much completely ruined by war, I mean the total human population is just shy of 100 million, but also just the general direction that the series is gonna go. At least at first. The world shown here isn't ruled by a federation or a Zeon, it's just small communities, townships, and city-states scraping just enough together to survive, like they're pooling all of their meager money together to buy just one mobile suit to defend their village. It's a really interesting concept, and one that Gundam X does really well. One thing that absolutely helps to sell the setting is Gundam X's use of color in the early arcs. You'll notice that everything is harsh and saturated. The world looks generally uncomfortable. Not to mention that they use this blood-red sky as set dressing in a lot of the early episodes, and it just looks great. It's something that I'll absolutely remember Gundam X for. Episode 2 begins with us being introduced to two freelance Gundam pilots working for the Freedon. These two want Tifa back and are much more skilled than Garrod in mobile suit combat. Not to mention they're also piloting Gundams. That's something I want to point out too, this show has a lot of Gundams, and it has a lot of upgrades to those Gundams. I can see the toy lines now. The two pilots inside the Gundam Leopard and the Gundam Airmaster are known as Robbie and Wits. Quick aside, Robbie's name is spelled R-O-A-B-E-A, and it's pronounced like three different ways in this show. So, I don't care, his name's Robbie. Also, Wits' voice actor is Kazuya Nakai, who I'm a huge fan of. He was recently Jin in Ghost of Tsushima, which I loved, but he's also Zoro in One Piece, so I can't not think of him as just Gundam Zoro. Garrod realizes that they're after Tifa, so he just puts her in the GX's hand and uses her as a shield, which is one thing I kind of love about Garrod. He's always being sneaky and tricking people in fights. Wits and Robbie are ordered not to pursue the GX while it flees. Garrod and Tifa land in the woods and build a fire, where Garrod tells her of his pretty troubling childhood. Yeah, the world immediately after the war sounds pretty horrible, what with the uncontrollable disease, the eternal nuclear winter, and the roving bands of cannibals. I'm just guessing on that last one. Their conversation is cut short by the arrival of a bunch of mobile suit riders that have been tracking the GX. And even though they take Garrod and Tifa by surprise, they're not actually able to capture the mobile suit, because all the bandits just turn on each other and start, like, scavenging each other's suits for parts. It's pretty crazy. When the two are backed into a corner by the small army of bandits that have appeared, Tifa asks Garrod if he wants power, and when he accepts, he uses her Newtype powers to contact an abandoned facility on the moon. This facility sends a microwave beam down which connects to the Gundam X and powers up its most dangerous weapon, the satellite cannon. Garrod fires the cannon, despite the crew of the Freedon begging him not to from afar. The cannon is incredibly powerful and blows away the entirety of the fighting mobile suits. However, this causes Tifa to go into shock, essentially taking psychic damage from the amount of death and destruction the satellite cannon has just caused. The GX is captured by the crew of the Freedon, and Garrod is thrown into the ship's brig. Luckily again, Garrod is a sneaky little bastard, and he happens to carry pixie dust in his pocket that knocks out his guard, letting him escape to roam the ship and eavesdrop before returning to the brig. He learns that Tifa will need a few days to recover, but ultimately she'll be fine. This episode also introduces us to the series' long antagonists, Shagia and Olba Frost. Shagia, the older brother, offers to bring Tifa a deal back to the alternative company, and though he'll eventually be pretty unsuccessful in this, it does set him up as a new type hunting force along with his brother. Speaking of Olba, he arrives at the Freedon in his admittedly really cool looking Gundam Asteron, sneaks aboard, injects Tifa with a strange substance, and then sneaks off and leaves. Garrod is caught sneaking out once more by the Freedon's captain, Jameel Neat, but this time it's to go and pick Tifa some flowers. He tells Jameel that he loves her and wants to stay by her side, and with that, Garrod is allowed on the Freedon and takes up the mantle of the pilot of the Gundam X. This is where one of my favorite aspects of Gundam X comes into play. They spend a lot of time letting you watch the crew of the Freedon interact and spend time together. Garrod has his childish love for Tifa that, all in all, is written fairly realistically for a 15-year-old, and beyond that, I really enjoy watching all of the characters bounce off of each other. It's an aspect that makes shows like One Piece and Eureka 7 quite enjoyable to me. The crew of characters that we get to spend a lot of time with and are just fun to be around in general. Speaking of Eureka 7, that show owes so much to Gundam X that it's not even funny. Not to spoil it, because I do really like Eureka 7 as well, but the setup and character dynamics, at least in the beginning of both series, is incredibly similar. When Tifa's condition seems to worsen, Jameel decides to take her to the alternative company labs to find a cure, which actually ends up being pretty easy because Olba ends up blasting through a wall with his Gundam and kidnapping her during a battle. Which begs the question, why didn't he just kidnap her when he injected her with the poison? This is the first in a long line of schemes that the Frosts come up with to either kidnap Tifa or destroy the GX. Honestly, none of them really work, and they're all pretty dumb. Anyway, in this arc, we learn that the captain of the Freedon, Jameel Neat, used to be a Newtype soldier for the old UNE, and he was actually the one responsible for firing that shot that caused the colony drop. Due to this, Jameel has PTSD, and he can't pilot a mobile suit, nor can he use his Newtype powers. When he tries, it just gives him incredibly bad migraines. This causes Garrod to take over the duties of piloting the GX for the Freedon crew, and ultimately they're able to use telepathic messages from Tifa to very carefully aim the satellite cannon and destroy the alternative company's base. Garrod becomes part of the crew quickly after saving Tifa, though we see that Wits and Robbie are freelancers and during much of the opening half of Gundam X they're sort of off doing their own thing, but also never too far away that they can't help out. Garrod gets upset that he's not allowed to see Tifa whenever he wants, and in an effort to try to be useful to the Freedon, he goes to scavenge parts from an old UNE power station. Of course, random vultures attack Garrod while he's there and they cause a meltdown, only barely escaping by using the satellite cannon to propel the GX away from the explosion. Garrod overhears the crew discussing what to do with him after his admittedly immature idea of going to the power plant. This causes him to just say screw it and go to sell the Gundam X. This arc introduces us to Enil-El, a female mobile suit pilot that offers to buy the Gundam X for $300 million. However, she does decide to try and steal the control unit from Garrod to get the GX for free, but he's too smart for that and just pulls a gun on her. I have to mention, I love the lighting in this scene. It's awesome and moody. Since this didn't work, Enil decides to go and attack the Freedon to try and draw Garrod out. Garrod also meets the Frost brothers, who tell him to keep piloting the GX because they want to fight him again and they want to see what he's made of. So with all this information, Garrod decides to get back in the GX once more and go help the Freedon out. They actually come up with a pretty cool plan during the battle where Garrod uses the satellite cannon, but he moves the GX before the microwave beam can hit it to power it up. When the beam touches the water of the lake they're hovering above, it basically acts as an orbital strike, killing Enil's men and driving off the Frost brothers. Seems really OP, but I guess you can really only do it while above water. 1 week passes, and we see that both Robbie and Wits have agreed to sign on to the Freedon as security. Jameel uses Tifa to sense where there are more new types, and she points them north to a place called Fort Severn. This is probably the largest and most secure city-state we've seen so far, and is run by a man named Mayor Nemoa. Nomoa talks with a young Newtype pilot named Karis while observing a huge mobile armor named the Petulia. He divulges his philosophy that Newtypes should be the ones to rule the world, and Karis is completely taken in by his speech. This is the first time we see this theme, but it's certainly not the last, as fighting over Newtypes and using them as tools becomes the main driving force for almost every faction in the near future. Karis can sense the approaching Freedons, so he goes out to intercept them, and this leads to a fight between him and Garrod. We can see that Garrod is currently just no match for a Newtype pilot, and this becomes a huge part of his motivation going forward. Of course, he wants to prove himself to Tifa, but now he also wants to prove that Newtypes aren't infallible, and he wants to be able to beat them. For now, though, he just has no chance, and Tifa willingly goes with Karis to save Garrod's life. Of course, this puts Garrod into a funk, believing he just wasn't good enough to save Tifa. Thank God this saving Tifa arc only lasts a couple episodes. I really get tired of the damsel in distress trope really quickly. Jameel gets Garrod over his funk by making him retrieve the Gundam control unit from a frozen lake. Then we get to see the upgraded GX named the X Divider. It's a pretty great upgrade with a shield that doubles as a huge scatter gun that really gets a lot of work in the series. In fact, the upgrade is powerful enough to make Shagia and Oba run away. Actually, take a shot every time the Frost Brothers run away from Garrod. You'll be wasted, so maybe really don't. It's revealed that these two are working for a UNE remnant under General Imzod, and they're searching for Newtypes to be used as weapons in the new government. Garrod and the other pilots train to fight off Newtype-controlled bits, while Tifa undergoes tests at Fort Severn. NLL shows up, and it's revealed that her late father was Rear Admiral L of the Space Revolutionary Army. He knew Mayor Nomoa, whose real name is Dr. Durat. He reveals his true plan to use the Petulia to kill everyone on Earth because he wants to finish what he started during the war. Garrod starts to believe that a regular human can beat a Newtype when he witnesses Jameel fight off Karis's bits with the GX. He also learns that Karis is an artificial Newtype created by Dr. Durat, and when told this, it shakes Karis's resolve. Karis confronts Durat about Tifa being a true Newtype, which is something he thought wasn't possible, and then decides to go out on patrol. Ultimately, Karis fights Garrod and loses, deciding to let Garrod kill him. He empties his handgun, but points it at the cockpit door, being shot by Garrod as it opens. Karis is rushed into surgery aboard the Freedon and miraculously survives, but there isn't long to celebrate as Anil kidnaps Karis and Durat starts up the Petulia and begins killing everyone in Fort Severn as the beginning of his revenge. Garrod is able to get close to the Petulia and get inside, saving Karis. We see the Petulia crash and Anil gets freaked out by Durat and kills him off camera. Karis makes a full recovery and decides to stay in Fort Severn to help rebuild, deciding to live after Garrod tells him that he accepts him for who he is. Now, the series follows this pattern of Tifa having a premonition and the Freedon going to help a Newtype out or get embroiled in conflict with other vultures or UNE remnants. We get this really strange arc with this guy named Dorza who hunts Newtype dolphins. Yes, that's a thing. And then he like takes their brains out and sticks them into the mobile suits to turn them into sonar. It's really stupid. More importantly, Tifa and Garrod observe the satellite system activating somewhere out in the ocean, so the Freedon sets out across the Pacific. They enter an area called the Sea of Lorelei and end up helping an old friend of Jameel's, in the form of a naked woman inside of a tube at the bottom of the ocean. Finally, the Freedon arrives in a bustling port town of Sains Island, and we see that life in the afterwar period isn't so terrible everywhere, as the island seems really nice. While the crew is on Sains Island, there's a whole mini-story with the bridge crew member Tanya meeting Enil and becoming friends. Of course, things go sour when Enil realizes that she's part of the Freedon crew, though she does refrain from killing them when she has the chance. The Freedon is headed towards the UNE island of Zonder Epta, where General Imzad is currently building the Gundam XX. We get to see the new UNE Council, who are attempting to bring the old government back to restore world order, though through rather imperialistic means, of course. The Frost Brothers answer directly to this UNE HQ and are given a special operations soldier named Katak Alzamil and his men in order to kidnap Tifa. They end up disguising themselves as stinky fishermen and sneaking aboard the Freedon. They go to kidnap Tifa, but are stopped by Jamil because he's not an idiot. They are taken captive until the Frosts and the UNE soldiers attack the Freedon, and Geroad remarks that the soldiers are much better trained than the vultures and bandits they've been fighting up till now. Kadok's soldiers jump out of the side of the Freedon during the battle, but Kadok is determined to kill everyone with a grenade, that is, until Tifa shows up, and he's taken aback by how easily she accepts him as a good man. Olba kills Kadok's men in the ocean, just because. Enil arrives on Zonder Epta looking to resupply, but is chased off by the Frosts. Her suit is damaged and she's injured, so she's actually rescued by the crew of the Freedon and taken on board to receive medical treatment. They then use her flight recorder to find the location of the island. The Freedon heads directly there, but are forced to surrender when they find the Double X, which has been built using the specifications of Jamil's personal GX unit from the war, is pointing its satellite cannon directly at them. The crew is taken hostage, but it isn't long until they all come up with an escape plan. Of course, Enil is included, but then she double-crosses them, but then Imzat double-crosses her. I mean, Enil, what are you doing at this point, really? Kadok decides to help the Freedon crew get Tifa back after he's gifted a drawing of his late wife and daughter, and realizes that Tifa, despite being a new type, is really just a person the same age as his daughter was. Kadok and Garrod catch up with Imzat's ship, and despite all of the Freedon's mobile suits sinking to the bottom of the ocean, they decide to board the ship directly and take control of the Double X. They do this with the help of Jamil and Tifa. Jamil finally decides that maybe the future is something that can be changed, and delivers a huge kick to the head of a guard. It's pretty cool. Once Garrod has the control unit, he steals the newly built Gundam Double X, though Kadok is unfortunately killed in the process. In the end, Imzat is betrayed by the Frosts, who are revealed to be failed artificial Newtypes designated as Category Fs, so they kill him for hurting their feelings, and Lord Bloodman, an old fat guy presumably with a lot of money, announces the formation of the new UNE in order to help pacify fighting in the Asian theater. The next arc involves the Freedon arriving in a small Southeast Asian country named Estard. Estard, along with its neighboring countries Northern Bell and Gastar, have formed an alliance to fight back against the encroaching new UNE rule. The Freedon decides to help out, minus Robbie, who doesn't really want to fight in an actual war, so he fucks off for about 5 episodes. This is also the part where the Frost Brothers recruit a bunch of weirdos to go and try and fight Garrod in one-off fights. None of them are super interesting and they all die in one episode, so it really doesn't matter and feels quite rushed. And as we'll see in the coming arcs, the show really starts to speed up to the point where there's just way too much content in way too little time. The new UNE attacks and destroys the country of Northern Bell, and then it offers a peace treaty to Gastar, which we learn is an ethnic enemy of Estard historically. I mean, they literally say the two countries have a history of ethnically cleansing each other, so yikes. Ultimately, the Freedon is forced to leave Estard as the new UNE takes control of Southeast Asia and annexes the entire area. On the bright side, the young President Willis learned how to be a little bit more mature thanks to his talks with Garrod. With no clear way to go, the Freedon decides to go to the hidden UNE Newtype labs, which they find with the help of Tifa's powers. We also see that the Frosts kill a pretty successful new type that failed to be Garrod, and the two reveal their true intentions, which is to kill every new type in the UNE military because they're mad that they aren't considered new types themselves. At the new type labs, Jamil goes inside alone and talks to Dr. Caron. He tells her not to study new types as weapons of war or he'll destroy her. Before she can blow up the Freedon, the Frost Brothers launch their evil scheme and destroy the Newtype labs, though not before a scientist can save Jamil with a free helicopter ride. Unfortunately, he's also a spy and kidnaps Tifa. It's then revealed that the new UNE knows that the space colonies still survive and that the SRA is still plotting to attack the Earth, meaning that the war never technically ended. The scientist who kidnapped Tifa is a SRA spy named Nikola, and he takes her into space using a very rare shuttle. He ends up taking her all the way to a colony named Cloud 9, the heart of the SRA. Here we meet Chancellor Cyrell, the leader of the SRA and main proponent of Newtypism. He believes that those born in space are Newtypes, and they're the next step in humanity who will usher in the future. Because Tifa was born on Earth, he doesn't consider her a new type, despite Nicola's insistence and her usage of powers to warn the Chancellor of a terrorist attack. See, the Chancellor is more concerned with new types being a national identity over any sort of mystical next step forward. The Freedon goes to a UNE supply base that Enil informs them about. This was actually a secret space force base that the defectors are using to return to the colonies. Jameel convinces them to take Garrod and keep the Double X as payment. The Freedon defends the base as they come under attack, and ultimately the crew has to sacrifice the ship that we've come to know as home in order to get Garrod into space, but he does get up there. Garrod is suspected of being a spy almost immediately, but escapes with the Double X, though he doesn't get the gist of space combat right away. He comes face to face with a man named Lancero of the SRA, who is Jameel's old rival, and has also lost his powers. Garrod is about to lose and explode, but is saved by the G-Falcon, an awesome space fighter, and is taken back to a base run by a rebel group called Satellicon. This is where you can feel the shortened runtime of Gundam X really take its toll, as the group Satellicon is introduced, blown up, and defeated all within one episode. The only surviving member of the group is Paula, the pilot of the G-Falcon, who along with Garrod hatches a plan to go and save Tifa. The SRA launches Operation Dahlia, which is a plan using a newly built colony laser from parts left over from the war. The SRA plans on shooting the Earth with it and then landing and taking over. Paula flies in as a distraction, and Garrod threatens to blow up the laser with the satellite cannon unless they hand over Tifa, which they do because Chancellor Cyrell hates her anyway. Garrod then blows up the colony laser anyway, which was really funny. And they escape back to Earth with the help of the G-Falcon, which can luckily survive atmospheric re-entry. Before they can escape, however, the new UNE army shows up led by Shagia and Olba, who tell Garrod the Freedon crew have been taken to forced labor camps in Siberia. The trio are then captured and taken to see Lord Bloodman. Bloodman asks Tifa to divulge information about the SRA, but she declines because she can just tell he's not a man to be trusted. When she looks into his mind, she sees the same thing that she saw when she looked inside Chancellor Cyrell of the SRA, plus one single word, dome, which she doesn't understand what it means, but when she says it out loud, everyone in the room freaks out, so it's gotta be important. Garrod and Tifa break out of the mansion, and they also rescue Paula along the way. Meanwhile, Karis actually is able to save the crew of the Freedon from being lined up along a mass grave and shot in Siberia. One thing that can really illustrate how rushed the final arcs of Gundam X is just Paula as a character in general. Now don't get me wrong, I like her and I think she's a very enjoyable character, but she's introduced in like the last 7 episodes, and along with her G-Falcon, which we're told can combine with any Gundam, they use it like one time to make the Leopard fly, and then just that's it, they never use it again. The Freedon crew head over to New Orleans and meet up with the North American Resistance, and the announcement is made about the mobilization of the new UNE Space Force. Tifa falls in a coma and won't wake up. She has a crazy dream where she meets this glowing orb who calls themselves Dome. Dome tells Tifa to come to the moon to learn the truth of everything, and when she wakes up, everyone agrees that they have to go to space. The crew steals a new spaceship from the North American Rebels, christening it the Freedon 2, and they make for the moon immediately. At the same time, the SRA and UNE have begun to battle around the moon facility, as both leaders fear the other side reaching Dome first. Jameel says that there's no way that this can happen because of the base's automated defenses, which we see include both turrets and bit mobile suits. These suits activate and escort the Freedon as well as the leaders of the UNE and SRA down to the abandoned base. Inside, they finally meet Dome, the being that was once called a Newtype. We learn that Dome was the first Newtype and that the UNE ended up dissecting him down to a genetic level, incorporating him into the very machinery of the moon base. Dome has this conversation with everyone, telling them that the whole reason everyone is fighting is because of the very concept of new types in the first place. Dome essentially says that new types aren't the next step of humanity, and that the superhuman powers that some people exhibit are a totally separate thing. You can't depend on Newtypes as a crutch to try and build a better future. You have to want to build a better future within your own heart to really achieve that. Dome uses Garrod as an example of this, saying that even though he's not a Newtype, he's changed the future that Tifa saw many times. Which is kind of a wishy-washy answer to all the questions that we had to ask, but all the characters treat it as like this giant revelation. Like, guys, no one figured this out. Like, no one ever thought that you would all have to work together to achieve peace. You needed to, like, hear it from a weird, disembodied, floating space orb. Okay. Of course, despite the wisdom imparted by Dome, the Frost Brothers destroy the UNE and SRA fleets. They face Garrod for a final battle, which ends in a huge beam clash, which destroys the moon base, along with all three Gundams. 6 months later, we see that Tifa and Garrod are living on Earth. Jameel and Sarah are working with the new UNE, because I guess he stopped caring about their ever-spreading imperialism, and Wits, Enil, Robbie, and Tanya are a foursome. At least in my headcanon. And that was the story, for the most part, of After-War Gundam X. Overall, I'd say I really enjoyed my watch through, despite the fact that I think there are a lot of flaws with the show in general. Obviously, the show being cut from 49 to 39 episodes really impacted the pacing, and it's very apparent in the second half of the show. Basically, after Garrod goes to space for the first time, that's when things start to feel like you're on a train with no brakes. This show is incredibly Newtype heavy, so if you don't like that, then I would say just give Gundam X a total skip. While the way Newtypes are looked at and utilized is probably the least mystical that we've ever seen, besides the dolphins, I guess, it is absolutely a focal point for a lot of the runtime. The designs are pretty good overall, but besides the GX and XX, I don't think a lot of the suits are standouts. The Leopard and Air Master are cool, but they don't really jump out at me, and the same goes for the two suits that the Frost Brothers use. The grunt suits in the show are actually pretty cool, especially the Dotress with its three eyes. Overall, I think the technical designs of the suits aren't bad, but they kind of do just feel like action figures to me. I guess at the end of the day, I understand why After War Gundam X is hit or miss for a lot of people. It's an interesting story, but halfway through it loses a lot of the steam that I felt it built up. That Mad Max and Fist of the North Star influence felt on the opening arcs quickly dissipates, and we get into a more standard Gundam setup of faction versus faction fighting. Just not one done as well as in other shows. However, if you like shows where the whole crew all hanging out on a big ship together is a big draw, well, Gundam X probably has you covered, because it's a huge part of the series. And also, you should probably go watch Eureka 7, because it's just incredibly similar. Anyway, those are my thoughts on After War Gundam X. If you enjoyed this video, please remember to like and hit subscribe. We do this every week where we release videos talking about Gundam and other anime in these long form type videos. It's been really fun. If you like that kind of content, check out the channel. There's tons of it. Anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed, and we will see you next time with Turn A Gundam. See you then. Hello and welcome to the end card. Whew, boy, this one was a trial. This, the version of this video that ended up coming out was the third one. Let's see, first we had the mic get all messed up by Logitech G-Hub. Then we had OBS version 28 absolutely destroy footage for three videos. But here we are, we busted ass, it's out. And here it is. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Thank you so much. If you made it all the way to the end card, you get an extra special thank you. Also, you'll notice a new part of the end card up in the top left corner. There is our channel members known as Ace Pilots here. Thank you very much to Lord Kagai for being our very first channel member. When there are enough channel members, we will have it scrolling like credits. But for now, here you are. If you guys want to be channel members, feel free to go ahead and do so. There's only one tier, although I don't want anyone to feel like they have to. In the future, I think we're going to have channel member exclusive polls, which are the same poll as the channel poll that just get, essentially, if you're a member, you get an extra vote. So I think that's going to be the main plan, plus obviously the emotes and everything. And I'm also planning when we do Patreon to give patrons an extra vote as well. So, hey man, if If you want to be a member and a patron, you have 3 votes, bro. That's fine by me. Anyway, look out next time for Turn A. We've got a ton of stuff coming up on the channel in September that I'm really excited about. Like, 7 videos are planned. Let's hope and cross our fingers that nothing goes wrong. And of course, in October, there's a ton of shit that's coming out for the channel I haven't talked about yet, but just Halloween's gonna be fun. Anyway, this end card has gone long, so again, thank you guys, thank you to our beautiful channel members, and I will see you next time.